Hey guys, how's it going? Kriparian here. Today we're going to do this. This is the tier list, the Krip list, if you may. We're going to be ranking some stuffs, and if you guys like these type of YouTube videos, maybe we'll make some more, and you guys can give us some advice on what you would like ranked. We wanted to kick it off with a pretty standard one that goes through all the different nostalgic periods in Hearthstone, because I know a lot of you guys are really long-time viewers and will get quite a kick out of it. Today we're going to rank expansion. How good I felt they were. Now, my perspective in this game is, I would say, the general kind. I play a little bit of Constructed, a lot in the first month, and then not very much after that. But I think that's pretty common as most players play. Play a lot of Arena, and I never miss a Tavern Brawl. I never miss any kind of special events. I play private matches with my friends and try to do some weird stuff there. I get the whole Hearthstone experience, and I've pretty much done that every single expansion. So how's the ranking system work? This is the typical ranking system. S tier is like super good tier. It's like the best ever. Nothing touches S tier unless you're playing like an Asian mobile game with like SSS plus or something like that. S is gonna be as good as it gets. Absolute perfection. Then A, pretty good. Some flaws, but quite good nevertheless. B is like, yeah, it's not bad. Some good things generally, on average, did better than the bad things. You know, the net was still positive. And C tier is kind of the reverse of that. There were some good things, but there were a few more negative things as part of that grouping or that expansion in this particular video. D, mostly crap. And E, basically entirely garbage. So you might have some pretty interesting ideas on how you would rank expansions, and maybe you can think of that as we begin ranking them, which we will do right now. We're going to start with Witchwood. Where is Witchwood going to go? The Witchwood expansion is a pretty interesting one where very few of the cards are actually played, with the main exception being Gen and Baku. Now, Gen and Baku ended up being mistakes by Blizzard's own admission, as they were taken out from Standard forcefully so just a few expansions later, not through the natural Standard rotation. So in terms of a Constructed player experience, you would think Witchwood is a pretty poor expansion, but I would say as an Arena perspective, it was actually not bad. And it was not bad because in Witchwood, we had a lot of mid-tier power cards, which are actually very healthy for the Arena mode. And obviously these cards never see play in Constructed, so that's why people might think Witchwood was a really bad expansion. But in Arena, it was actually not bad. Now I have to weigh in the fact that most people play Constructed and not Arena. So in this very particular case, we're going to rank Witchwood C tier. It's pretty okay. There's some ups, there's some downs, depending on which game mode you play. Journey to Un'Garo. Un'Garo was a very interesting expansion. It was very well themed. I remember on the night before Un'Garo was being released, I actually went over to World of Warcraft just to explore the zone to show people what's up with Un'Garo. Un'Garo had the quests, and the quests were very cool. We had Adapt. We had a lot of like dinosaurs and stuff. It was a very well themed expansion. In general, game balance, quests, they were either really bad or a bit frustrating to deal with. We're talking about the birth of like Quest Rogue. Yeah, Quest Mage was a really fun deck in my opinion, but probably not in the opinion of many of my opponents, I would say. Journey to Un'Garo in general, though, most importantly, was quite fun. I'm gonna rank it in the B tier. It could be a lot better if not for some of the very oppressive and the very underused quests. The main mechanic in this expansion were these quests, and it was also, I think, if not the first time, maybe the second time, but I think it was the first time we had much more legendaries in one expansion, and it made it so a little bit more pay to win on the first few weeks of the expansion to get the cards that you want. Next up, Grand Tournament. Whoa, that's a bit of a clunker. So what do we get out of the Grand Tournament? We got a lot of cards that saw basically no play, and they were generally Inspire cards and Jousting cards. Understandably so, those cards are not easy to play. We did get one card that was notably powerful from this expansion, and that was Mysterious Challenger. It was the card that birthed Secret Paladin, the extremely oppressive mid-range deck that basically couldn't be beat and played a fairly simplistic Curvestone, Zoostone type of game. Now, typically when we have low power expansions for Constructed, as I mentioned previously with the Witchwood, that can actually be a good environment for Arena. Turns out, not the case for the Grand Tournament. All those cards that saw no play in Constructed actually destroyed Arena, because Arena, typically you need to leverage certain risks and have a pretty well-balanced deck, but with Inspire cards, the same cards that basically nobody ever played in Constructed, they basically ruined Arena, because you could play four drops with Inspire, and they would be mid-range cards as well as late-game cards. So everyone ended up chasing these same cards and essentially having mid-range decks that could compete with Constructed control decks. It also made it so if you're winning, Inspire is obviously a much stronger mechanic because hero powers are low tempo plays. So if you're already winning, it was very easy to close out the game using these cards because they're very win more, which again, not so good. It was also, I think, the single turning point in the game where first versus second had a drastic separation. It was much better to go first than second, starting from the Grand Tournament. If there was a rank below E, it would go right there, but thankfully for the Grand Tournament, E is as low as it gets. Rise of Shadows, we just got this expansion. Where are we going? Are we going near the bottom, near the top? I don't know. Rise of Shadows has been a pretty thrilling expansion, in my opinion. They've been trying a lot of new things with the development cycle. We've seen lots of balance patches, lots of game updates. We've seen the two separated arena modes. So in the first 2 months, we had a separate set of expansions participating in the arena format. In the last 2 months of the expansion, a different set of expansions for the arena format. So Arena Base got a whole facelift, and it was quite exciting. They struggled a bit balancing the classes with the buckets, but I guess that's fairly understandable because it's a fairly new system. In terms of Constructed, I think people were generally happy. Yes, there were some pretty oppressive Tier 1 decks, but much more so than most other expansions, I would say that Rise of Shadows introduced a lot, like a ton of Tier 2 decks. And the game is pretty fun to play when there's a ton of decks that can win in the game. So Rise of Shadows gets points for that. In terms of the Dalaran Heist, the PvE adventure, I would say it's pretty good. Not quite the best ever, but pretty good. I think Rise of Shadows is a very solid effort from Blizzard. I'm going to give it an A. I would give it like an A+, but we'll give it an A for now. The reason I can't give it S is I just feel like a few other expansions were a bit more exceptional, and I wouldn't quite say it's equal to the best ones in my mind. And we'll see what those are in a second. Next up, Rastakhan's Rumble. So this is a pretty interesting one. We've got the Trolls again. Very well-themed expansion. Very cool, like, Loas. Very cool cards. Very nice PvE adventure, I would say. This is where Arena tried to take off and try to rebalance the buckets more aggressively throughout, the weeks and the months that were unfolding throughout the expansion. Overall, I have to say Rastakhan's Rumble was, again, a very solid effort from Blizzard. A rank for me. Whispers of the Old Gods. This is the expansion that I typically use as my benchmark for the greatest ever. I'm just going to drop it in the S rank. You guys know I'd be teasing you guys otherwise. Whispers of the Old Gods, if you recall, was the introduction of the standard format. Now, certainly some people don't like the standard format. Some people prefer the old version of Hearthstone. That's fair. That's fine. From an arena's perspective, the standard format made it so you once again had some strategy in order to play around some cards. Right before Whispers of the Old Gods, there were so many cards being played in Arena that even though you were quite sure your opponent had a specific one, on average, it was just better to play into everything. So the standard rotation, the standard format being introduced in Whispers of the Old Gods was a really big improvement for the game, especially the arena game that I play. And I think the Constructed game, I think these days people will agree, if you've played Wild recently, you know that there are differences in playing Wild than Standard, let's just say. Whispers of the Old Gods also had probably the most Tier 2 decks out of any expansion. You could literally just play an Old God with some of the supportive cards and make a mid-range deck out of it, and it was pretty good. You could just play almost anything that you want, and it was decent. It worked. Arena had very good balance as a result of this, and more importantly, new players actually came to the game from what I saw. I don't have the numbers to back it, but in my opinion, from the people that I saw watching these videos, watching the streams, the questions I was getting, the number of people and their, you know, skill level, let's say, that I would face in the different play modes, I feel like Whispers of the Old Gods did a great job of attracting new players. And I think it largely did that through the smart introduction of the C'Thun. Yeah, everyone got C'Thun, and the supporting cards are all pretty common, and basically every version of C'Thun deck was a deck that could win pretty reasonably most games. Next up, Curse of Naxxramas. Naxxramas is a pretty interesting expansion. In hindsight, I think it's one of the classics. I actually quite like it, but I have to compare it to the expansions that came after it, and in doing so, I have to put Naxxramas, maybe not in the D, let's put it in the C rank. So Naxxramas, it was a very good expansion at the time because, well, it was the only expansion, and we had been playing with the classic set for quite some time. Blizzard did not make too many updates to the classic set. It was pretty clear early on that they were moving into a basically content cycle that just pumped out cards as often as possible. The Naxxramas also introduced the adventure format. I thought the Naxxramas adventures were actually pretty well balanced, so I actually really like the Naxxramas adventures, but there are very few cards being introduced into the game from Naxxramas. More importantly, there were cards that were very problematic to the game. We had like the Leroy Miracle Rogue get Lotheb, and it made it so Lotheb either, you know, Lotheb was a great card later on, but until they made some adjustments to Miracle Rogue, it was like a plague to deal with that thing. Constant Leroys and just Lotheb with Shadow Steps in some cases. Very frustrating, not very fun to play against that. It also introduced the Undertaker format. Undertaker was the most oppressive deck in the history of Hearthstone. Nothing touched Undertaker. How crazy is that? Yeah. They had the nerf Undertaker and they took their sweet time because it really took some time before these decks cycled out. I mean, we had Undertaker Priest as like the only historic powerful Zoo Priest deck. It was that ridiculous. League of the Explorers, often regarded as one of the best expansions ever, I would say it actually is kind of bad. I'm going to put it in the D tier. League of Explorers is an expansion that introduced some really cool cards. It had a very nice adventure with the League of Explorers, but it wasn't a very well-balanced adventure. I just kind of ran through it pretty quickly. There was not much of a challenge. It was pretty well done thematically, but in terms of like actual challenge, actual balance, replayability, I would say it was pretty weak. Nothing really stood out for me on League of Explorers in that sense. A lot of people like League of Explorers because they had cards like Bran, cool. They had cards like Reno Jackson. Oh my god, Reno Jackson, the best card ever, right? Such a cool concept. It is such a cool concept, but when you actually start playing with these cards and you're trying to win, you realize that even this card that people really enjoyed from League of Explorers was a really bad one. It was found out maybe a few weeks into the expansion that the best way to play around Reno Jackson decks is to assume they don't have any of the answers that are in their deck at any time, because the odds were in your favor that they didn't, because they didn't have two of anything, because it was a Reno deck. While it was pretty fun to play Constructed, to kind of experiment with these decks, League of Explorers Constructed fell off really fast after its original introduction. We also had, in the second half of the expansion, the fabled Overload mid-range aggressive Shaman deck. We're talking about Tunnel Trog. Tunnel Trog is in that expansion, okay? So League of Explorers, it had some cool concepts, but its overall impact to the game, I would say, was quite negative. Kobolds and Catacombs. Kobolds and Catacombs had some extremely high power level cards, so it can be pretty frustrating to play Constructed when there's like such a huge turn up. I think it was the last expansion of the year, so we kind of expected that, but nevertheless, super high level cards coming out from Kobolds and Catacombs, which I think is relatively a bad thing in general. Arena during Kobolds was not great. Nothing memorable. I remember, you know, Fungal Mancer just destroying everyone. But Kobolds and Catacombs introduced the Dungeon Run. And because of that, I'm giving it an A. The Dungeon Run was really a masterpiece. Possibly Dalaran Heist has, for the first time, done better than Dungeon Run for PvE content, but it's pretty close. Dungeon Run kind of set the standard for what we expect for PvE content from Hearthstone, and it did that because it's really good. It's just really good. It was really fun to play, very cool concepts, and with Blizzard's terrible AI, somehow they made it work. One Night in Karazhan. Oh my god. Let me just put this right at the bottom. Really, again, I've talked about this expansion many times. One Night in Karazhan was, in my opinion, the poorest expansion in Hearthstone. The PvE adventure was the worst in terms of balance. I think it was Netherspite or something. Netherspite on normal, you start with 10 mana, and so you just play a deck full of big minions and you kill them right away. So you're like, okay, that was normal, whatever. Do heroic. Heroic, he has like 10 or 20 more health. That's it. That's ridiculous. Just a small bit of additional health. It doesn't increase the challenge at all. I remember feeling the most disappointment playing the adventure that Karazhan introduced. In terms of the meta in Constructed, it was nothing really special, but for Arena, it was horrible. At that time in Arena, cards are being offered based on their rarity, and also had an occurrence boost for class cards and spells. So One Night in Karazhan actually had a lot of common spells introduced. So we had like Firelance Portal for Mage. Mage is the best class in the game by a lot. And they got Firelance Portal, which is one of the all-time best Arena cards. And you'd play Arena and you'd draft like four or five of them just about every time. And then Priest got like Purify. This is when the community came in and were like, WTF Blizzard, why is Priest getting such a crappy card, especially for Arena, when it's like, you know, Priest is like the worst ever right now. So luckily Blizzard stepped in for Purify, but there are a lot more blunders in that expansion. It just didn't really feel like it was quite Blizzard quality across the board in my mind. Goblin versus Gnomes, the first full-featured expansion that we ever got. It was once again a pretty big increase to power creep, but it was a lot of cards and it was pretty fun to play outside of maybe some Dr. Boom shenanigans. I would say Goblin vs. Gnomes was a pretty cool expansion. It kind of set the trend for Hearthstone, and I think it kind of set the trend because esports grew a lot during Goblin vs. Gnomes, that there was a lot of RNG in Hearthstone. That's when there's a lot of eyes on the game, and it was a bit unfortunate that Goblin vs. Gnomes highlighted that. It was an expansion with perhaps a bit more RNG than the others, but overall, I think it was pretty well done. It was just a fun time to play the game at the time, and I have to give it A rank for that. Certainly had some issues, but the good aspects, especially compared to the whole history of Hearthstone, I think overall do pretty well. Mean Streets of Gadgetzan. So a very well-themed expansion, kind of cool. I was a bit disappointed to have, you know, basically Goblin versus Gnomes round two, but it didn't really become that. Mean Streets of Gadgetzan, a lot of people liked it, but I think in terms of the new player base, it was the worst. And I think because of that, I'm going to go right ahead and put it in the E rank. Mean Streets of Gadgetzan was the turning point for me playing my alt accounts. I had three alt accounts that I played regularly. I did all the daily quests. I did all the brawls on all of my accounts, including the three alt ones. I had two on Europe because I was with Anya and Greece at the time. And I had one on Asia, and I had my main account on North America. So basically, I would just run through all this content every single time. I'd make some whatever mid-range decks every expansion, maybe open up some, like, you know, 20 packs from the gold I saved. Maybe really rarely I would do, like, you know, an arena run on one of these accounts, but in Mean Streets of Gadgetzan, I just couldn't do that anymore. Playing was just not fun at all. It was the point where people were playing Jade Druids, and Jade Druid was so ridiculously good that it was close to unstoppable. To beat Jade Druid, you had to play Jade Druid or play one of the other, like, tier 1 decks. Like, tier 3 decks, none of them could beat Jade Druid. Jade Druid is just so ridiculous at that point. It's just not really fun to play with it. We also had patches. We also had, like, Pirate Warriors around this time. It was just overall no good, man. No good. Mean Streets of Gadgetzan was really horrible for the game, especially for the growth of the new player base. Knights of the Frozen Throne. Before Knights of the Frozen Throne came out, people would ask me, what do you think the next expansion will be about, Crip? And I'd always answer Ice Crown, because it's just the best. That's just the best aspect of Warcraft lore, even. And I just wanted to see it. So, honestly, I really liked Knights of the Frozen Throne on a personal level. I'm gonna put it on B rank, but I understand I am a bit biased on this, because this is the expansion theme I have always wanted in Hearthstone. And I mean, we have two basically Goblin versus Gnomes expansion. I wouldn't mind if Blizzard made another Ice Crown / Northrend / Arthas expansion. Please, Blizzard, I would enjoy it very much. Understandably, though, it was really fun to play with all the different Death Knight cards. Lots of, you know, cool cards introduced, lots of high power cards that were actually played and fun and all that. In the long term, the Death Knight cards got a little bit out of control. After a few weeks, people realized just how crazy they are in Arena. They had to ban Death Knights from Arena because at one point, yeah, basically every single opponent past 6 wins was a mage who also happened to get lucky enough to draft Frostless Jaina exactly. You know, this is a really terrible game state, but they kind of fixed things eventually. They, like, nerfed Druid because that was also out of control with UI and all that kind of stuff. A lot of bad things came from Knights of the Frozen Throne, but I just love my Arthas, man. Boomsday Project! Hasn't been too long since this has come out, you think, but no, it's been out a while. Boomsday Project is basically, well, Goblin vs. Gnomes around 3, but not exactly. Yeah, we got Dr. Boom, yeah, we got some mechs, but it was done in a very fun and whimsical way that I very much enjoyed. Boomsday Project also had one of the best arena metas I've ever seen, and because of that, I have to rank it S. We had some good times in Constructed, and we had some really, really good times in Arena. It was a fun-themed expansion, and nowadays we're actually seeing quite a bit of play from it still, so why not? Black Rock Mountain. This is a pretty interesting one. Black Rock Mountain is an expansion that introduced crazy combo decks with Emperor Tharsin, but they weren't too oppressive right away. Emperor Tharsin became a problem around the time of, like, pre-Whispers of the Old Gods, when the normal set, because there was no standard, the normal set that you played was getting rather large. Combos are getting actually pretty oppressive using Emperor Tharsin. It was also the birth of Grim Patron Warrior. Now, I liked Grim Patron Warrior, and I think it was good for the game, because skillful players would win with that deck, and bad players would not win with that deck. So you'd actually have to learn to play well in order to see good results. But overall, I would say Black Rock Mountain receives a C. Even though it was kind of fun with some of the cards, the adventure itself was not bad. It did introduce a lot of problem cards, and by today's standards, it wasn't much of an expansion. You know, not a lot of cards, fairly weak PvE content. We need higher standards these days for expansions. Now, you might think that's it, but it's not. There is one more to talk about, and that is the original Hearthstone. The original Hearthstone gets an S, guys, obviously. I think the original Hearthstone is the reason why we play Hearthstone today. It introduced us to the game. Original Hearthstone I think is evidently the best, or at least tied with The Old Gods and probably Boomsday as well, because they just spent more time on it. That's how they developed the game. They had a controlled state and they were working on this for a long time, and it was just fun to play. Everything was so well themed, everything from, you know, the sounds of World of Warcraft that we loved to the lore from like Warcraft 3 that we played through. It came together in the card game that we play today, and the classic set, the original vanilla Hearthstone, is the reason why many of us are here today. Let me know what you think. Let me know some cool topics you might like me to rank, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.